Welcome you to worship. Happy New Year. I know you still think we have a month to go, but the most important calendar that we follow is the church calendar. And on the church calendar, this is a brand new year. Notice the color behind me. It is blue. Blue is the color of hope. It's a relatively new color in the church calendar. And in fact, I will tell you, the Advent wreath is a relatively new innovation. I know you all think that the Advent wreath has been around forever. It's not. It's only been around since the 70s. 1970s, I'm talking about. And same thing with the color blue. It came into existence about the same time. Prior to that, we always used purple. Well, that was the color of Lent and a color of repentance and preparation. But we wanted a hopeful color for this season. And this is especially appropriate because I know you are all about wrung out of hope. So I'm going to be here to announce some hope to you today. Doesn't matter how tragic the circumstances, how difficult this season has been for us, we have hope, and the hope is in Jesus Christ. I don't want to waste my time on announcements today. You can see most of those on our Facebook page. I would like to get straight to the hope of this season as we light our first Advent candle for today. So let us prepare our hearts. Watch and wait, for Christmas is coming. During the season of Advent, we light candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, remembering the promise of God with a prayer. And so today we light our very first candle, the candle of hope. Hear a promise of hope from the book of Isaiah. God promises us in these words, "In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many people shall come and say, 'Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths.' Out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore." Let us pray. Faithful God, out of war's chaos, you bring the order of peace. Renew our hope that we may work toward Christ's advent of peace amongst all nations. God of promise, God of hope, into our darkness, come. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. By your merciful protection, waken us to the threatening dangers of our sin, and keep us blameless until the coming of your new day. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first lesson for today is found in the book of Isaiah, the 64th chapter. The prophet writes, "Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways, but you are angry. We sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean. All our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you've hidden your face from us, and you have delivered us into the hand of the iniquity. Yet you, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord. Do not remember our iniquity forever. Consider, we are all your children." Here ends the lesson. Our psalm for today is Psalm 80. You're welcome again, the congregation, to respond with every other frame. "Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who are enthroned upon the cherubim. Shine forth before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. Stir up your might. Come to save us all. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with your people's prayers? You have fed with them the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in full measure. You make us the scorn of neighbors. Our enemies laugh amongst themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved. But let your hand be upon the one at your right hand, the one whom you made strong for yourself. Then we will never turn back from you. Give us life, and we will call on your name. Restore us, O Lord, God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved." Our gospel lesson for today is found in the book of Mark. I apologize, you do not have it in front of me. Mark chapter 13, the gospel of our Lord. Jesus said, "But in those days following that distress, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time people will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And he will send his angels to gather together the elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twig gets tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when these things happen, you know that it is near, right at the door. Truly I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. But about that day or that hour, no one knows, even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard, be alert. You do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going away. He leaves his house and puts his servants in charge, each with their own assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether it's in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Bless us, God, today as we open up our heart to your word. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We do invite you to take a look at the handout for today again. Handouts are always found on our Facebook pages, the announcement for today, the link to the service. There are always one or two JPEGs, almost always one or two JPEGs attached underneath the announcement for the sermon that you can download and print off. And so we encourage you to follow along if you'd like to for your devotional purposes. So we begin a brand new gospel lesson with the brand new year. So we had been looking at the Gospel of Matthew all last year. We're looking at the Gospel of Mark over the course of this next year. And so that's kind of exciting. Mark is that real snappy gospel account where it's one action after another. Jesus does this, and then he does this, and then he does that. So we get to see Jesus in a lot of activity, a lot of action, but on occasion he pauses, stops, and speaks. So we're in a little bit different context than what we were in the last week, although it's still in the end of times lessons that Jesus is preaching. So let's go through this, set up the context, a little bit different than we were in when we were in the Gospel of Matthew. The previous lessons took place right after Jesus' final confrontation with the scribes and the Pharisees. So he's just outside of the temple. That was in Matthew. But we're not in Matthew anymore. We're in the Gospel of Mark. Jesus' words in the Gospel of Matthew were an indictment and condemnation of the Pharisees. But today, in this lesson, he's down another week or so, and he's actually preparing his disciples. He's just entered triumphantly through Palm Sunday. Of course, this lesson takes place between Palm Sunday and the Last Supper. So we've moved ahead another week or so. All right? Jesus is with the disciples in Jerusalem preparing for the Passover meal. Now, it was an exciting time to be in Jerusalem because there were so many travelers and so many pilgrims that were present. The disciples were in awe as they looked at the temple and said, "Goodness, have you seen anything more spectacular?" Well, Jesus has a few words of warning for them about what is going to happen to that temple. Now, a little bit about that temple. The temple in Jerusalem was called Herod's Temple. Herod the Great, not to be confused with the Herod who put Jesus to death. That was Herod's son. So this was the third temple that occupied that space in Jerusalem. Of course, there's the original one built by David, Solomon, David's son. Then that was destroyed. Then you had the second one that was rebuilt by Nehemiah after the Jews came back from captivity in Babylon. That one was destroyed. And now we've got a third one going up. This one, again, was built by Herod the Great. Construction of this temple began around 19 BC, about 14 years before Jesus was born. As I said, commissioned by Herod the Great, it was mentioned at the time of Jesus' birth. But Herod the Great died around 4 BC. So that's why we know our calendars are a bit off. We know that this really should not be 2020. This actually should probably be 2024, because that's about the year, if we're dating it from the time Jesus was born, our calendars are a bit off by a few years. Nevertheless, as I mentioned to you, this was the father of Herod the Great. Herod the Great was the father of Herod who put Jesus to death. The temple, Herod's temple, was never completed. In fact, it was destroyed. But at the time of Jesus, as it was going up, it was still a thing of great beauty. It was a source of Jewish pride. It was seen as a physical manifestation of God's presence with them and of God's approval of the Jews. take a look at the next page, Jesus' prediction. Here's what Jesus says, and he predicts something in front of his disciples that would have been unthinkable and unspeakable, and people would have really gotten upset about it had they heard Jesus say this. He predicts the destruction of the temple, which is astonishing, absolutely unbearable thought to the Jews, who again associated God's presence with the temple. So much of Jewish identity was tied up in that temple mythology. Now, what's odd about it is, as I said to you, for many generations, the temple didn't exist. And the Jews did just fine. In fact, there were many years they weren't even in Jerusalem. But they'd forgotten those lessons, that God was with them regardless of the physical manifestation of that temple. All that is left, as I said, this temple was destroyed about 70 AD by the Romans because the Jews kind of kicked the Romans out. And they kind of had a nice time, couple of years of freedom from the oppressive nature of the Romans. Well, the Romans came back in abundance and with a vengeance, and they kicked the Jews out, where the Jews never returned, all the way until 1948. So over 1900 years, almost 1900 years, the Jews were expelled from the city of Jerusalem and from Israel itself. All that was left, in fact, all that's left of that temple today, is what we call the Wailing Wall. Maybe you've heard of it. Jewish and Christian pilgrims go to the Wailing Wall often as a place of prayer. On top of the Wailing Wall is, of course, the Dome of the Rock. It's a Muslim mosque that is now built in the place where the temple once was. The destruction of the temple, Jesus predicting this, would have been interpreted, as I mentioned to you, by the Jews as God's abandonment of them. So Jesus is trying to prepare his disciples for the destruction of the temple to remind them that even with the temple being destroyed and the Jews being scattered, God would still be with them. It would require them to rethink their relationship with God that is not based upon a building, but upon God's promise for them. Objects, buildings, institutions are not a manifestation of God's presence and love for this, for us. So here's what this means, I think, for us. We should not place our hope or faith in a building, in a program, in a pastor, in an institution, or even in our country, or certainly not our politicians. See, there's nothing that annoys me more than Christians who wrap themselves in the flag as though our flag of the United States of America represents the presence of God. Oh, God has blessed our nation so much. Like God doesn't care about the other nations of the world? Are you kidding me? God cares about Germany. God cares about France. God cares about China. God cares about Japan and Russia and Kazakhstan and Guatemala. God loves and blesses all of them and people all over the world. We are not a specially blessed nation. We Christians need to stop wrapping ourselves in the flag as though this somehow represents the presence of Jesus Christ, because it doesn't, and it never has. Jesus Christ represents the presence of Jesus Christ. Not our symbols, not the institutions that we build. They come, they go. The United States is going to come, it's going to go. Someday this country won't be here. And you know what? That's okay. Because we will have Jesus. So here's what happened as a result of the temple's destruction. Maybe I just floored half of you because you're like, what? The pastor's talking about our country being destroyed? It could happen. Could happen in my lifetime. This country might never exist again. So what? Don't put your trust in nations or presidents or politicians. See, this is what happened to the Jews back in the day. A tragic event, as tragic an event as the destruction of the temple may have been for the Jews, it was the impetus for what we call the diaspora. The diaspora is the great scattering of the Jews after the destruction of the temple and after the Romans took over Israel once again and kicked them out. So the Jews were scattered throughout the world. The scattering of the Jews throughout the world led to the wide the spread of Christianity. So, how amazing is that? The destruction of nation of Israel led to the blessing of the world with our faith, into you becoming a Christian. God took this terrible tragedy, a national tragedy for the Jews, and turned it into a source of blessing for the world. And that's exactly what the Jews were created to do. They were created to be a blessing to the world. It took the destruction of their temple. It took the destruction of their country. It took the scattering of the Jews throughout the world for this world to be blessed. And I would say the same thing's true with us. Our country could be destroyed. These things could happen. We lose our institutions. You know what? Whatever it is, God is going to use that for good. The worldwide blessing was always God's intention and choice for the Jews anyway. It's why, oh, by the way, religious Jews always were vehemently opposed to reoccupying the promised land. They thought that was a promise in the past that was gone. Religious Jews were against resettling in 1948 the nation of Israel. The only people who wanted to settle there were capitalists who wanted to invest their money there, and secular Jews. Religious Jews thought it was a stupid idea. Because why would you want to resettle in Israel when you're out in the world blessing everybody? Why would you want to settle in one small place in the world? It's a dumb idea. And so what we need to do in amidst the chaos of this life is put our trust in God, not in the objects that we can see or feel, because they all fade away. So this lesson is really appropriate for us today. Many of our human-made institutions are on the verge of collapse, oftentimes because people are putting pressure on them intentionally with the idea hoping that they will fail. They may succeed someday. It's okay. Many Christians, again, have their identity wrapped up in the flag and in our public institutions, but this is not of God. God is not in our flag. God is not in the United States of America. God is in our hearts. It doesn't matter the country. It doesn't matter the type of politics. What matters is that God is here. And wherever we might be, we represent Jesus Christ. So Jesus' words today, he's drawing up a picture for us of great cataclysmic destruction and saying, it's okay. I am with you. His words are meant to be a comfort to us. We are to watch, the Bible says. God will not let us down. Watch what God is going to do. Something spectacular. You might think the entire world is falling apart and burning to crisp right now. Everything is falling in around you. All the institutions you thought you could trust. So what? Put your trust in God. God is the God who, out of chaos, ordered the universe. God is the God who, out of death, brings new life. God is the God who, out of destruction of our human-made institutions, blessed the world with his love. Look up. Stop looking at politicians. Stop looking at our country. Stop looking at your flag. Start looking up and looking at Jesus. Because that's where our hope is. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you be with us and give us hope. Because we have built these institutions that we thought would last forever. Well, for goodness sakes, are human-made institutions. And they fall apart and they decay. They become corruptible. They're corruptible and so they become corrupted. But the kingdom of heaven, Jesus Christ, the gift of your love, well, that's uncorruptible. We give you thanks that the best news of all is Jesus Christ. So let's stop looking out. Let's start looking up. Let us see Jesus, the hope of the world. Amen.
the bleak midwinter, frosty windy bow. Earth stood hard as iron, water like a stone. Snow had fallen, snow on snow. In the bleak cannot hold him nor sustain. Heaven and earth shall flee away when he comes to reign. In the bleak midwinter, a stable place suffices. Lord God Almighty, angels and archangels, they have gathered there. Cherubim and seraphim thronged in the air. But his mother only, in her maiden bliss, worship the
Let us confess together the faith, this time not in the Apostles' Creed, but in the Nicene Creed. So with the whole church, we confess together our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, one God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father, he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who, with the Father and the Son, is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Advent hope that we share this day. Oh, we know that these events of which we read occurred 2,000 years ago, and we live in that hopefulness of Christ coming again, of bringing us home to be with him and all of those saints in that church triumphant. But God, in this time in between, we have short memories. One day we remember the great blessings that you've given to us, and we rejoice, and the next we are forgotten, and we feel as though we've been abandoned. And so amidst our feeling of abandonment in this season, we pray that you would restore our hope. There are families that are separated, families that cannot get together due to the illness that has struck this world. There are relationships that have been broken and strained. People who've lost jobs. Heavenly Father, just in our own community, a place of employment, and we don't have many of them, but they employed literally 100 or so folks, just closed recently. The building's being sold. Just such a devastation for those families as they enter into a new year, not even knowing how they're going to put food on the table for their families. So I'm praying that you would bless all those who are unemployed. And those of us, God, who still have sources of income, help us to be generous. Because as you poured yourself out for us, you invite us to participate in the working of Jesus Christ, your love, your peace, and your justice in this world. We just take a moment, God, to lift up all those concerns upon our hearts this day. Confess to you our doubts and our sorrows, our fears. And we trust that you will pick us up. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all those for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer the Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
And now receive the Lord's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jesus, our sons and
serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.